Peter and the Wolf is a musical tale in which the various characters are represented by different instruments in the orchestra. The bird is played by the flute. The duck by the oboe. The wily old cat by the clarinet. Peter's grumpy old grandfather is played by the bassoon. The wicked wolf by three horns. Peter, the brave hero, by all the strings of the orchestra. While the hunter's guns are represented by the kettle drum and the bass drum. Here then, is the story of Peter and the Wolf. Early one morning, Peter opened the gate and went out into the big green meadow. On a branch of a big tree sat a little bird, Peter's friend. "All is quiet," chirped the bird. "Nothing to report." Just then, a duck came waddling along. She was glad that Peter had not shut the gate and decided to take a nice swim in the deep pond in the meadow. Seeing the duck, the little bird flew down upon the grass, settled next to her, and shook his feathers. "What kind of bird are you if you can't fly?" said he. To this the duck replied, "What kind of bird are you if you can't swim?" and dived into the pond. They argued and argued, the duck swimming in the pond, the little bird hopping along the shore. Suddenly, something caught Peter's attention. He noticed a cat crawling through the grass. The cat thought, "The bird is busy arguing. I'll just grab him." Stealthily, she crept towards him on her velvet paws. Shouted Peter, and the bird immediately flew up into the tree. While the duck quacked angrily at the cat. From the middle of the pond. Crawled round the tree and thought, "Is it worth climbing up so high? By the time I get there, the bird will have flown away." Grandfather came out. He was angry because Peter had gone out into the meadow. "It is a dangerous place. If a wolf came out of the forest, what would you do then, eh?" Paid no attention to his grandfather's words. Boys like him are not afraid of wolves. Grandfather took Peter by the hand, led him home, and locked the gate. sooner had Peter gone in than a big grey wolf did come out of the forest. As a flash, the cat climbed up into the tree. The duck quacked and, in her excitement, jumped right out of the pond. No matter how hard the duck tried to run, she couldn't escape the wolf. He was getting nearer, nearer, catching up with her, and then he got her. And with one gulp, swallowed her. And now, this is how things stood. The cat was sitting on one branch of the tree. The bird on another. Not too close to the cat. Wolf walked round and round the tree, looking up at them both with greedy eyes. In the meantime, Peter, without the slightest fear, stood behind the closed gate, watching all that was going on. He ran home, got a strong rope, and climbed up the high stone wall. One of the branches of the tree, round which the wolf was walking, stretched out over the wall. Grabbing hold of the branch, Peter lightly climbed over into the tree. Peter said to the bird, "Fly down and circle round the wolf's head. Only take care that he doesn't catch you." The bird almost touched the wolf's head with his wings, while the wolf snapped angrily at him from this side and that. How the bird infuriated the wolf! How the wolf wanted to catch him! But the bird was too clever, and the wolf simply couldn't do anything about it. Meanwhile, Peter made a lasso and carefully let it down. Caught the wolf by the tail and pulled with all his might. Feeling himself caught, the wolf began to jump wildly, trying to get loose. Tied the other end of the rope to the tree. And the wolf's jumping only made the rope round his tail tighter. Just then, the hunters came out of the woods. Following the wolf's trail and shooting as they went. Thank you. Peter, who was sitting in the tree, shouted, "Don't shoot! The little bird and I have caught the wolf! Please help us to take him to the zoo!" Now. Imagine the triumphant procession. Peter at the head. After Peter came the hunters, leading the wolf. Winding up the procession, Grandfather and the cat. Grandfather tossed his head grumpily. "Well, and what if Peter hadn't caught the wolf? What then, eh?" Above them flew the little bird, chirping merrily. "My, what brave fellows we are, Peter and I. Look what we've caught." And if you listen very carefully, you can hear the duck quacking inside the wolf, because the wolf in his hurry had swallowed her alive. Thank you.
Once there lived a big and wonderfully clever pig. To everybody it was plain that Piggy had a massive brain. He worked out sums inside his head. There was no book he hadn't read. He knew what made an airplane fly. He knew how engines worked and why. He knew all this, but in the end, one question drove him round the bend. He simply couldn't puzzle out what life was really all about. What was the reason for his birth? Why was he placed upon this earth? His giant brain went round and round. Alas, no answer could be found. Till suddenly, one wondrous night, all in a flash, he saw the light. He jumped up like a ballet dancer and yelled, "By gum, I've got the answer. They want my bacon, slice by slice, to sell at a tremendous price. They want my tender, juicy chops to put in all the butcher shops. They want my pork to make a roast, and that's the part that'll cost the most. They want my sausages in strings. They even want my chitterlings. The butcher shop, the carving knife. That is the reason for my life." Such thoughts as these are not designed to give a pig great peace of mind. Next morning, in comes Farmer Bland, a pail of pig swill in his hand. And Piggy, with a mighty roar, bashes the farmer to the floor. Now comes a rather grisly bit, so let's not make too much of it. Except that you must understand that Piggy did eat Farmer Bland. He ate him up from head to toe, chewing the pieces nice and slow. It took an hour to reach the feet because there was so much to eat. And when he'd finished, Pig, of course, felt absolutely no remorse. Slowly he scratched his brainy head, and with a little smile he said, "I had a fairly powerful hunch that he might have me for his lunch. And so, because I feared the worst, I thought I'd better eat him first." Afternoon, I said to Mummy, "Who is this person in my tummy? He must be small and very thin, or how could he have gotten in?" My mother said from where she sat, "It isn't nice to talk like that." "It's true," I cried. "I swear it, Mummy, there is a person in my tummy. He talks to me at night in bed. He's always asking to be fed. Throughout the day, he screams at me, demanding sugar buns for tea. He tells me it is not a sin to go and raid the biscuit tin. I know quite well it's awfully wrong to guzzle food the whole day long, but really I can't help it, Mummy, not with this person in my tummy." "You horrid child," my mother cried. "Admit it right away, you've lied. You're simply trying to produce a silly, asinine excuse. You are the greedy, guzzling brat, and that is why you're always fat." I tried once more. "Believe me, Mummy, there is a person in my tummy." "I've had enough," my mother said. "You'd better go at once to bed." Just then, a nicely timed event delivered me from punishment. Deep in my tummy something stirred, and then an awful noise was heard. A snorting, grumbling, grunting sound that made my tummy jump around. My darling mother really died. My goodness, what was that? She cried. At once the tummy voice came through. It shouted, "Hey there, listen you, I'm getting hungry. I want eats. I want lots of chocs and sweets. Get me half a pound of nuts. Look snappy or I'll twist your guts." "That's him," I cried. "He's in my tummy. So now do you believe me, Mummy?" But Mummy answered nothing more, for she had fainted on the floor. Animal is half so vile as Crocky Walk the Crocodile. On Saturdays he likes to crunch six juicy children for his lunch, and he especially enjoys just three of each. Three girls, three boys. He smears the boys to make them hot with mustard from the mustard pot, but mustard doesn't go with girls. It tastes all wrong with plaits and curls. With them what goes extremely well is butterscotch and caramel. It's such a super marvelous treat when boys are hot and girls are sweet. At least that's Crocky's point of view. He ought to know. He's had a few. That's all for now. It's time for bed. Lie down and rest your sleepy head. Shh! Listen. What is that I hear? Galumphing softly up the stair. Go lock the door and fetch my gun. Go on, child, hurry, quickly, run. No, stop, stand back. He's coming in. Oh, look, that greasy, greenish skin. The shining teeth, the greedy smile. It's Crocky Walk, the crocodile.